Welcome back, fellow biologists. Justin here. I want you to imagine that you are on the cusp of a groundbreaking scientific discovery. This discovery could change everything we know about life science and improve the lives of billions of people. But you've hit a small roadblock that is preventing you from completing this breakthrough. Meanwhile, across the globe, another scientist has discovered a solution to this very stumbling block that's holding you back. This is fantastic news, if you knew about it. There's just one problem. This other scientist didn't share their results with anybody. So your incredible breakthrough is going to have to wait. And that's a real shame, because one of our superpowers as humans is that we can share discoveries and ideas with each other. It's how we learned to grow and harvest crops, treat bacterial infections, and even perform open heart surgery. Together, we can accomplish some pretty incredible feats. As Isaac Newton once said, "If I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants." In today's lesson, we'll be exploring this concept of scientific collaboration as we describe two reasons why communicating scientific results is important, explain how scientific results are communicated, and describe how theories are developed. Let's get into it. As we've discussed throughout this unit, biologists perform investigations to answer questions about living things. But the scientific process doesn't stop once a conclusion is drawn. The final step, and one of the most crucial ones, is the communication of results. Why is this so important? I'm sure you might have a few ideas. The first reason is simple: to add to the growing body of knowledge that we all share. The world is too complicated for us to understand it all by ourselves. When scientists read about each other's work, it helps them with their current projects and gives them new ideas for more investigations. For example, the discovery of penicillin by Alexander Fleming in 1928 paved the way for the development of antibiotics, which are used to treat bacterial infections today. That's pretty awesome, but how can scientists be sure that their results are correct? Do scientists just take each other's word for it? No, not at all. The second reason scientists communicate their findings is so that other scientists can double-check their work. Have you ever had someone check your homework or measurements to make sure they're correct? Scientists do that too, by replicating or repeating each other's investigations to see if they get the same results. Investigations that are unable to be replicated are not seen as credible or believable by the scientific community. For example, in the 1950s, the Tobacco Industry Research Committee promoted flawed research, claiming there was no relationship between smoking cigarettes and increased risk of lung cancer. "Smoking is totally healthy," they said. But because these results were never replicated, they were disregarded by the scientific community. In this way, science double checks itself. And cigarettes are definitely bad for your lungs, by the way. Okay, now that we've discussed the why of communication, then how do scientists actually share their results with each other? Well, they do this by creating a scientific report. These are typically typed up and then published in scientific journals, where other scientists can read them as well. In these reports, scientists don't just talk about their conclusion, they also explain their procedure, or all the specific steps they took in their investigation, so other scientists can follow along. This is just like when you follow a step-by-step recipe when you're baking cookies. A recipe provides ingredients, measurements, and mixing and baking instructions. Without these details, you couldn't make the cookies yourself. The same goes for scientific investigations. If the procedure isn't detailed and complete, other scientists can't replicate the study and confirm the findings. A scientific report includes all the steps of the scientific method, including a scientist's initial observations, the question they wanted to answer, their hypothesis, and all of the steps of their investigation and analysis. For experiments, this includes explaining the conditions for the control group and constants as well. When other scientists repeat the investigation, they're following the same steps and testing the same hypothesis to see if they agree with the results. If many scientists find the same thing, then the hypothesis might be due for an upgrade. You may have heard people use the words hypothesis and theory like they mean the same thing, but in science, a theory is not the same thing as a hypothesis. A scientific theory is a well-supported explanation of how things work, based on lots of evidence. When a hypothesis has been tested and proven many times, it can become a theory. Let's look at an example. Until the late 1800s, we didn't know how diseases were caused. Consequently, we also didn't know much about how to effectively treat people when they got sick. It was common for parents to lose a child to diseases such as polio, diphtheria, and measles. Imagine yourself as a biologist during this time period. You probably would have made some concerning observations, and I imagine you would certainly have had some very serious questions. Luckily for us, so did the biologists of the time. Louis Pasteur and Robert Koch, among others, hypothesized that microorganisms could cause diseases. They conducted numerous experiments to demonstrate that specific germs were responsible for specific illnesses. Over time, their hypothesis was supported by a vast body of evidence, leading to the development of the germ theory of disease. This theory is considered one of the most important scientific discoveries of all time because it led to advancements in hygiene, sterilization of medical equipment, treatment of viral and bacterial infections, and so much more. As a result, the quality of life for billions of people has dramatically improved. So when you hear someone say, "Oh, that's just a scientific theory," maybe point out to them that a theory is the closest thing we have in science to the truth, or absolute certainty. Theories are kind of a big deal. They're the product of countless scientists working together, making discoveries, and gathering evidence as part of a larger community. Who knows what we'll discover as we continue to observe the world, ask questions, and investigate the world around us. Only time will tell, but one thing's for certain: we won't be alone. There will be plenty of scientists from the past and the present backing us up. And I'm pretty confident that together, we'll discover some pretty awesome things. And with that, we have wrapped up our lesson on scientific communication. We learned that scientists communicate their findings to contribute knowledge to the world and so that other scientists can double-check their results. Scientists communicate using scientific reports, which detail their procedures so that other scientists can follow along. Finally, when a hypothesis is tested and proven over and over again, it becomes a theory, or a well-established explanation. In our next unit, we'll dive into the microscopic world of cells, the smallest unit of life. Until then, I'm Justin, and remember, life is full of wonders. So keep learning, and don't ever stop wondering. Hey.